Hi everyone, thank you so much for joining another LeadSquared webinar session. For anyone joining in Bangalore, I hope wherever you've joined from, you have good internet service because you will need it for this session. It is a bond day here for the rest of people who join from other places. So anyway, getting back to the topic, the session today is on growth hacking. And our guest today, our speaker, Rishabh Dev, who is a regular at these sessions now, he is going to tell you how you can 10x your growth in 2018. So Rishabh, he is the managing director at Mapplinks, and this is probably his umpteenth session with LeadSquared. So Rishabh, over to you. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, about Mapplinks, and how you're going to take the session forward.
Great. Thank you so much, Shivani. I think I can already see some familiar names in the attendees, and it's good to be back doing a LeadSquared webinar again. So I run two different businesses. I run the growth hacking education company, which is Mapplinks Academy, and I run the growth hacking services company, which is Mapplinks. And all in all, I think over the last few years, we've done growth hacking campaigns for more than 60 clients, including startups, small businesses, and large corporates. It's fun to see how large corporates are evolving with growth hacking. In 2018 is going to be like really big in terms of growth hacking. Now, this presentation is going to be more about the hacks and a little less about the process, which is because most of the times I spend developing the process and talking about the process. And I think this time I want to make it a little different and talk about the hacks, because I know a lot of you are now in the phase where you're, you know, making your marketing plans, designing campaigns, brainstorming ideas to achieve your goals from digital marketing, from growth hacking for 2018. So let's get started. And before we actually move into the hacks, I also have a little bit of mindset development for you. And what we're going to do is, we're going to start by building the mindset, and then we're going to move to the actual growth hacks. So let's just get this started. Now, so these are the three businesses, the three companies that I run, and we're going to start building with the mindset exercise. So this is a quick exercise where I want people to participate. And my simple question to you here on this slide is, if you know who this guy is, just type his name in the chat box, and we're going to look at this later. Everyone who gets the name right is going to get my next ebook on growth hacking for free. So I'm going to send you my growth hacking ebook, which is coming soon, which is the top 25 growth hacks for 2018 for free, if you can guess the name of this person. So I'm giving you a minute or so. If you know the name, put it in the chat box, and you're going to receive my ebook.
Right, guys. So as Rishabh said, please share his name on the question panel. That's where you can share your questions and answers. So all those of you who want to get his ebook, come on, let's see some answers. So we have a couple of really funny answers coming up. Vinay says, is he the new king of Japan?
He's close, because he is somewhere from close to Japan, but he's definitely not the new king. I don't even think he looks like one. But yes, he is half Japanese, but he was born in the US, so he's now American. That's one hint that I can give you. That's a funny answer. Do we have any more funny answers?
Not a funny answer, but Will, I think, has got the right answer. I'm not going to say it out right now. I'm just waiting for a couple of other answers to come in. So yeah, another funny answer by Yashash. He says he looks like the guy in The Last Samurai. He says, yeah, the actor. So yeah, I think Will has got the answer right, but even I'm not sure actually who he is. So Rishabh, you want to just look at the questions there? Or I'll just tell you what he said.
Yeah, that's cool. So I'm gonna proceed. But if you think he's got the right answer, let me know and stop me so that I can then put him on my list of getting the free ebook. So this guy is, I'll tell you about him a little bit before I disclose his name. He's a six-time hot dog eating championship winner. And even though he doesn't look like one, that's exactly what he does. He eats hot dogs. And you can consider that being his full-time profession. We call such people food hackers. And the mindset that this person has is the same mindset that you would see in a growth hacker. So that this is why I bring this up, because in my opinion, he's a growth hacker. His name is Kobayashi. Is that the name that the person got?
Shibani, yes. So that we have three winners actually. So Will Simpson, and then there's Suri, and then there's Fabio. So all three of you get a free ebook. Yay! Well done.
Amazing. Three people. Amazing. I guess I probably, when I do seminars and webinars, there's usually one person who gets it right. That's also very rare. Scenario. So I think we have a great audience. So this guy is a growth hacker in my opinion, because if you see in the slide, he's up against guys like these when he's competing in these eating contests. And this is his Wikipedia page, so you could go and look him up on Wikipedia as well. But what I had the opportunity to do is to interview him over my blog, and we had a conversation online, and we discussed about his method. Which I sort of translated into a growth hacking method. Now, hot dog eating is an art, and as for this guy, there are a lot of loopholes and opportunities that you need to find. So I'm going to share with you his three-step growth hacking process, and this is sort of like the pre-step. So I want you to put your growth hacking hats on and just learn this mindset which he follows. So the first step, which is step zero, like the pre-first step, is that he drinks a lot of water 60 minutes before the contest. So when I say a lot of water, there have been reports that he drinks around 3 liters of water, 5 liters of water, and so on. He doesn't disclose the exact amount, but there's definitely a lot of water that he drinks before the start of the contest. Now, we are going to identify the growth hackers today in the webinar. So if you are a growth hacker, if you think that you can put your growth mindset on, you will feel free to guess in the chat box as to why he drinks all of this water. So again, I'm going to give you 1 minute to guess. This is a mindset building exercise, so I want people to participate. Guess why he drinks all of this water before the hot dog eating contest. So let's hear a couple of answers, Shibani, as we get them, and then we move to the next step.
Right. So Vasan says to expand the stomach. Fabio says to get his stomach larger. Amit says to prepare for saliva needed. Karun says again to expand his stomach and get more space. Most of the answers are to enlarge his stomach.
Absolutely. Now that's the right answer, but the way he gets to this step is also following a growth hacking process or a growth mindset. So he experiments with different things. Just like we A/B test, different campaigns. He experiments with milk. He experiments with water. He experiments with soda. He realizes that milk works the best when it comes to expanding your stomach. However, it does have a lot of calories, which balances out with the number of hot dogs that he's able to eat because of a result of the stomach expansion, which means that water is definitely the best option. Now, step one, which is really the first step after when he is actually into the contest, is that he separates the sausages from the buns. And before we go on to step two, which will tell you why he does this, again, if you have any ideas, put your growth hats on and put in the chat box what do you think. Why do you think he separates the sausages from the buns? So let's hear some answers. Again, we give this a minute before we go to step two.
Wow, I don't know if this is an answer pertaining to this, but he says, Alagu says defining goals. And then Yukti says it's easier to eat same kind of food at a time. Sandeep says easy to eat. Vinayak says to reduce the digestion time.
Wow, very, very smart audience today. However, this guy is a little more smarter than the rest of us. And we're going to figure that out in step two. Now, this is a GIF. However, I don't want to play it because it's really disgusting. But you have a complete video on YouTube which you can watch. Essentially, what he does is he slides the sausages, which are basically very easy to just swallow, and the buns are separated because he dips the buns in water. Now the advantage of doing that is if you do the data analysis, you can find out that the equivalent of 8 to 9 hot dogs, if you separate the buns you can hold in the palm of your hand the equivalent of 8 to 9 hot dog buns if you dip them in water. So when you dip them in water, you have the buns absorb water, and it's okay to drink water while you're in the contest. And this is the reason why he actually separated the hot dog buns in the first place. And now it's really, really easy to eat, because imagine having to eat 8 hot dogs versus having to eat buns in the palm of your hand soaked in water. It's going to be much easier to finish that. And in my opinion, this is exactly how a growth hacker thinks. So this is the mindset that a growth hacker should have. Now, if you look at this, this whole process, you'll find that there are 4 things that Kobayashi does. The first thing is that he doubts the default way of participating in the contest, which would be, hey, this is the hot dog, let's start eating the hot dogs and eat as fast as possible, you have a time limit. But he doubted the default way. He also found opportunities or loopholes. Now, one loophole, for instance, is a lot of the participants do not drink milk or water and so on with the contest, because they think it might be against the rules of the contest. But the rules of the contest never say that you cannot drink water. Similarly, there are no rules in digital marketing, so long as you can find opportunities or loopholes with different channels or with different sources of traffic and so forth. The third thing is he gets creative with his process. Similarly, for marketeers, I think one of the problems with digital marketing today is we have these fixed channels that we all look towards to achieve a goal. So we get a goal, business goal is, let's say, to drive more traffic, to drive more leads, to get more signups, to promote your e-commerce business. And you always look for the same things. You always look for Facebook ads, you turn to Google ads, you turn to SEO, stuff like that. So there's no creativity in that sense. Because of getting creative, he also saves time and money, which is more applicable to the digital marketing process. So this is the mindset that I want you to attend this webinar with, which is why we did this quick exercise. And we're going to move into the reason why we need to get creative and find opportunities. So I typically like to start before I move into growth hacking, I like to share this anecdote with everyone to tell them why exactly are we talking about growth hacking in the first place. So this is a graph of the Facebook stock price versus the average organic page reach of business pages on Facebook. So if you see, the average organic page reach in October was 12%, and it comes down to around, not even 6.5 to 7 in Feb. So the idea here is that you see that as the stock price increases, which is indicated by the bars, the channels mature and they reduce your reach. So you cannot depend on these heavily mature channels, because they're going to grow and they're going to want you to spend more on ads. So essentially what the ecosystem is currently in a situation where organic marketing needs a long time. So if you're starting now, or if you have a new business goal for 2018, if you have a new team for 2018, you'll realize that you will mostly be doing either of these two things. You'll be either doing organic marketing or you'll be doing paid digital marketing, which is you'll be either doing ads or you'll be doing content and calendars and boosting them and so on. You'll find that organic will always take a lot of time and paid will always need a lot of budget. So growth hacking comes in to solve this problem. And the idea of growth hacking is to get business results faster and cheaper, which means with less budgets and less time. So that is essentially why we are doing this webinar today and why all businesses need to adopt growth hacking in 2018. So now, if you're all ready, let's get started and discuss my top 10 picks of growth hacks for 2018. Now, this is going to be a combination of both B2B and B2C hacks. This is also going to be industry agnostic, so you can apply this to any industry. These 10 growth hacks are definitely not the only ones for 2018, but these are the ones which have worked over and over again for different kinds of clients in 2017 and would continue to work on different channels, on various channels in 2018. So when I go and consult clients, I'm currently consulting businesses like Philips and Airbus in creating their growth hacking campaigns, and even a lot of startups. I would definitely recommend them these growth hacks first before we have to, you know, get into the entire process. Now, you should also understand before we get started that there has been a growth hacking process. There is a 16-step growth hacking process which we have put in place, which includes agile, which includes experimentation, which includes A-B tests, which includes running parallel growth experiments, which includes OMTM analysis, and all of that stuff in order to come up with these top 10 hacks. And it's always better if you can learn the process, you can build your own hacks. However, this time I'm going to share the top hacks with you, which you can just go and plug into your business. So hack number one, this is I put this as the number one hack because this has never been discussed before. And I find it really amusing that this has been overlooked by a lot of people. And the hack is simple. This is an example, and I'm going to explain the hack to you through an example. Now, this is a blog on mental health issues, and the hack has been implemented by a company called BetterHelp. BetterHelp is a mobile app and a web app which you can use to sort of consult and get help for your mental health issues. And this is a blog about mental health. So if you see the image here that says, don't ignore the warning signs of depression, get the support you deserve and need, and it says image better help, right? So this is an image attribution hack, and essentially it works like this. You find the channel which is a high influential blog with the same target audience as your business, and I'm not talking about guest blogging here, I'm just talking about image attribution, and you have a lot of free images that you can get from different websites. You can use Unsplash, Pexel, and so forth. And you use these images and you submit these images to different blogs. So for example, make a list of all the blogs which write on topics which are applicable to your target audience as well. And then you know, you'll find that a lot of these blogs don't have images. Just give them the right image. You can edit the image a little if you want. And you can even have a link back, you can have a logo, you can have your company name as the image source just below the image. And BetterHelp, just by this hack, got 1,000 daily unique visitors, a lot of link clicks, a lot of SEO value because they could convert a lot of backlinks through this process, conversions and branding without having to really go through a huge content calendar or a huge you know, sort of a guest blogging content team and stuff like that. So very, very simple process, and the steps are pretty simple. You find high ranking websites, you make sure they have the same target audience as yours, you find articles, you give them images, and we call this concept the concept of OPB, which is other people's blogs. The general concept when you think about growth hacking, you need to think OPN. OPN stands for other people's networks. How can we use traffic or followers or visitors that other people have to drive the same for our business or our website or startup? So in this case, we are using the concept of other people's blogs. Now, before I move on to the second one, after every growth hack, we'll see if there's any question that we want to answer. And if not, I'll move forward with the second hack. So Shibani, let me know if there's any question which we should take up for the first one before we proceed.
Not yet, but I'll let you know as soon as they come in. I think we can go on. Yeah. In fact, people from the audience are asking you to go on as well.
Sure, sounds great. This is going to be basically taking notes. When I do the process seminars, there are so many questions, but when I talk about the hacks, people are busy you know, taking screenshots and notes and so forth. So the second hack, which I've been using for a long time, and it has never failed to work, which is why I've included that in this list. It's definitely going to continue to work, and it's going to work for both B2B and B2C. And what it does is it uses the Twitter advanced search to generate highly qualified leads for your business. The reason these are highly qualified leads is because they are exactly looking for the solution that you provide. This is a quick example which I was just searching for in the morning today. There's this Boolean operator. So all you do is you go to search.twitter.com. That's the website you have to go and search this, and you put the Boolean operators looking for and whatever you're selling. So if you're selling t-shirts, you're selling custom t-shirts, let's say if you're not B2B, you're selling custom t-shirts, it could be looking for and custom t-shirts. It could be looking for and recruitment firms, for instance. If you're running a staffing business, you could say looking for and staffing companies. You can also include more keywords. You can include an or operator with the and. So you can say looking for and growth hackers or digital marketeers, and growth hackers or digital marketeers could be in brackets. So you use that parentheses operator, and then you have results of people who are tweeting with this sort of match. So if you see here, I have a couple of results. This says the Mobile Nations team is also looking for data and SEO analysts, growth hackers, and more. So that's the process. It's very simple, straightforward. Sometimes you can even find the email IDs of people who are looking for growth hackers or whatever you're selling. What I like to do as a next step is I run a script on this page, put all their Twitter handles, which the script basically enters all their Twitter handles, puts them in an Excel sheet, and I can run a sort of a job on the Excel sheet to tweet to these people that I am a growth hacker if they need some help, or I have a team. If they're looking for growth hacking campaigns, we can help them with that. I wouldn't manually go and apply for all of these results, but if they're very relevant and if they have email addresses, I'm going to run a script which pulls out all that data for me. That's where the tech aspect of growth hacking comes in. So you need marketing and you need tech, and it's a combination of the two things. This also works fairly well if you're B2C and you have a target audience which you know is going to look for something specific regarding your business. So simple growth hack, just go to Twitter, advanced search, and you can experiment a lot with Boolean operators. You can also put a time range on this. For instance, you can say only people looking for growth hacking in the last month. So you can do from date, starting date, to end date. A simple growth hack uses other people's tweets, so OPT, basically other people's networks. In this case, the other people's networks is other people's tweets to find very qualified leads. Now, the reason I said very qualified is now clear, because you can see that these people are actually looking for that specific service or that specific product. So go ahead, try this out on Twitter, and you can always tweet to me if you have any questions on this. Should I move forward to the next one?
Not yet. We have a couple of questions now, Rishabh. So starting with Hiren's question, so he says, for image hacks, should the logo image have more content?
I didn't get that, sorry. I mean, the image that you submit.
If I just read it out as it is, he says, for image hacks, should the logo image be with more content?
Okay, so I mean, not really clear, but I think what he's trying to ask is the nature of the image that we submit. So it's typically like a free image. You can submit any image. You may not need to put your company logo on it. All you need is a credit that you have submitted this image with a link back to your business. It's the fastest way of getting a link back. If you're editing the image and you want to put something on the image, that's fine. But I think I would avoid putting a logo, because the chances of getting the image into a very high level blog. Let's say, for example, when I submit a blog to entrepreneur.com and I put my logo on the image, they probably might not include that image on their blog. It also depends on the size of the blog that you're approaching to. In that sense, what you can do is you can have smaller blogs. You can reach out to smaller blogs, make a list of all the blogs who accept your image, and then take that list to the bigger blogs and say, hey, these are the guys who I've contributed images for, and they've given me attribution. Would you like me to do the same for this blog, because I think that your blog is not visually appealing or misses a visual aspect, an element which I can contribute to. If you have a designer, or if you can use Canva, the process is going to be even better for you, and you can do all sorts of things with this growth hack. Anything else?
Hiren has now I don't particularly understand this question, but you may. He says, what is the script, how to run it?
Right, so there are two kinds of scripts that run. One is in the backend, and then one is a JavaScript. If you have a developer in-house, or if you know a developer, if you are a developer, it's going to be fairly simple for you. The JavaScript runs on this page, on the search results page, and it's going to pull out the usernames, the Twitter usernames, and put them in a Google Sheet. It can also pull out the first name, the username, the date, and the tweet text. That's fairly simple because it's all on your browser. JavaScript runs on your browser. It pulls out all of this information, organizes this into a nice Google Sheet. You can import this into a tool. You can import this into Hootsuite or something like that, or Buffer or anything to schedule automated tweets to these people. Or you can import this into your own job and run it in the backend and tweet to these people. If you don't necessarily are a backend developer, you can use a tool like Hootsuite to run this script. Anything else?
Okay. Yeah, a couple more. Just Prerna said, is this a paid feature in Twitter?
No.
I mean, advanced the hack in general.
Yeah, it's not. You can extract all the data for free, and then when you're running a script, if you're making your own script, it's okay. Otherwise, that's something that you might have to pay a developer for. But there's no feature. This is not a paid feature. The Boolean search is public. I don't know why many people don't use it, but that's the advantage. That's the growth hack. That's the opportunity for us. The URL that you go to is search.twitter.com. However, you can search this. You can put this query anywhere on the Twitter search. It's absolutely free.
Okay, and coming to the last question, just before we go to the next hack, and maybe for the convenience of others who just joined in, so here the Kajal's question is, can you please elaborate on advanced search option on Twitter?
Right, so advanced search is basically, so typically what you do is you go and put a keyword and search for it. Advanced search lets you do and, or, and other Boolean operators. So just to give you a brief, there are different features in advanced search. You have Boolean, you have dates, so you can have a duration. You can select that I want to see tweets from this month to this month, because let's say you're promoting a campaign which is time-bound. You might not want to get results which are 3 years old or something like that. It also has multiple options for emotions. Do you want to search for tweets with a positive emotion, negative emotion, and so on? I also have a list of Boolean operators that you can use. Probably you can just Google Mapplinks, you know, Twitter advanced search, Boolean operators, and you'll get that list. Or Shibani can send it across to you later, or you can tweet to me. But there's a huge list of and or operators. But what you'll be essentially using for this growth hack are going to be three things. So the first thing is you need to use and. So you put looking for and growth hackers is the keyword for me, because I'm selling growth hacking. If you're selling something else, if you're selling staffing solutions, like I said, you put looking for and staffing services. The other thing you'll be using is or. So you can say looking for or I need, you know, I need is a good keyword to search for, or I am looking for, or I require something like that. So you have these four options. You put or operators in between, and you put and then you put growth hackers or digital marketeers and so on. So you can use and or operators with different keywords. I think that should be the that should be enough for you to start getting leads. And just to give you an example, if I put looking for and growth hackers, and I limit the search for 2017. And I run a script on this page, I get around 400 leads in a day, you know. And the good thing is this is a never-ending lead generation source, because people keep tweeting with their requirements. So if I run the script once a week, I definitely do not need to have a lead generation, you know, traditional lead generation process in place. Also, the other advantage of this is that they're very, very qualified, because I'm putting keywords like looking for in this case. So I hope that clarifies Twitter advanced search as well. We'll move on to the next hack. Shibani,
there is one more question. Prerna actually says, so she says, is extracting or pulling out the data through a JavaScript like email ID is somewhat data laundering? What's your take on that?
So I'm not putting out email IDs here. So I'm whatever is available on the page. So let me explain you like this. I can have someone from my team to copy paste the usernames from this list, or I can have someone go and reply to this person. For example, let's take this example. So I have this person, Jared, who says the Mobile Nations is looking for, and I can favorite this, I can follow this, and I can reply to him, right? But it's going to take me a lot of time to do all of this for 100 people. So I make it easier for me by running a script. I'm not getting any data which is not available on the page itself, or not getting any data which you cannot get manually without having to go hacking into the system. It's just the same job that you would do manually. I'm automating it and making it easier for me. One of the things which is very important in growth hacking is you can use growth hacking for both ethical and non-ethical reasons, but we are going to stick to the ethical ones, which means we're just going to use technology to speed up things or to improve our lives in that sense by making less manual efforts and not to hack into a system and get email IDs and stuff like that. That's absolutely not what I'm doing here. If they do have their email ID in the tweet, I would be happy to have a script pull out those email IDs from the tweet, because that means they want me to send them an email. I'm helping them, I'm helping myself, and I'm not getting any data outside of what's available publicly. Most of these tweets are public, that's why they're showing in advanced search. So go ahead and just run these scripts, it doesn't matter. There are different growth hacks. There are growth hacks which are unethical as well. We're not talking about those hacks in this presentation.
Right. We can move forward. She says, sure, thanks.
Okay, cool. This is our channel is Twitter. The medium is other people's tweets, and the result is generating highly qualified people to sell to. This another example. If you're selling candles, you can just search for anything. You can search for need candles, want candles. Those are the kinds of keywords that people are actually tweeting about. So this is a tweet from 13 hours back. I need more candles. So people just tweet out things in very humane language, and we just need to search, find keywords like I need, I'm looking for, I'm searching for, or I need recommendations and stuff like that. You can try the same thing on LinkedIn. You can try the same thing on Facebook groups. You can try the same thing using Facebook graph search. There's so many things which you can do with Boolean operators. But this is a specific application of Boolean operators on Twitter advanced search. The next hack is to do with search. Now, everyone wants to rank on search, and there are a lot of local businesses who tend to lose out on the process, because what they do is they're essentially competing for the same keywords as the big businesses and the global businesses sometimes. So this hack is going to help you rank in a matter of a few weeks. In Bangalore, if you search for growth hacking consultant, this is one of the hacks that I implemented for myself some time back. And we started ranking for the first thing that shows up if you search for growth hacking consultant locally for Bangalore, because that's where I have majority of my clients are based in Core Mangla in Bangalore. So when you search for something like this, you will see my results in one of the positions on the local pack. So just before we get into this hack, I want to make sure that everyone understands what the local pack is. So before you have the first result on the Google search page for any keyword, you have this local pack with three results, three or four results, which shows the local businesses, based on the area that you're searching for. This is something that we call rank zero, because it's before rank one. So it's much better. I think this is one of the listings that I put up a week back before I started ranking for the keyword. And if I was competing for growth hacking consultant on the first result, it would have taken me I don't know how many months to do that. So this is the growth hack. I think growth hackers don't really get into the concept of SEO as much, in terms of doing SEO for a few years to start ranking for short tail or long tail keywords. I think growth hackers think of faster ways and hacks to get their search results outside to people. So this is something that worked really well for me. And I'm going to just share the process with you. So first of all, we all know what the local pack is now. This is how the local pack looks. So it has these three results and it has more places. It is a zeroth position on Google because it is above the first result. And now we're going to learn how to get this rank zero. And it's a very simple process. The first thing you do is you find your golden goose keyword. Now, for me, it's growth hacking consultant. It's the keyword for me. It could be anything for you. Even if you're not a consultant, it doesn't matter. If you're selling candles, it's okay. You can say the candle making shop or whatever it is. But what you need to do is you need to optimize and create a Google business listing around these golden goose keywords, and make sure you have competitive keywords and not the keywords that everyone else is using, but keywords that people are searching for. That's the basic rule of SEO. And then the most important step is that you boost the keyword density, include LSI keywords. I hope everyone is aware of LSI keywords. Include LSI keywords in your listing, and also get a couple of reviews by your fans or by your students or by your clients, whatever kind of business you're in, by your customers, to have review your business. And I've written this in great detail on Medium, how to use Google My Business Listing to 10x local search traffic. The fun thing, the hack after this is really interesting. So what I did is, once I was ranking for this in Bangalore, in Koramangala in Bangalore, I started finding virtual offices in different parts of the world. And virtual offices are like these offices where you pay a monthly amount just to have the address. However, if you just want a Google Maps listing, you can get it for really cheap. You can talk to the virtual offices anywhere in the world and tell them that I want a confirmation on the address. Now, you don't even need to go to that level. If you have family and friends in different cities in India probably, and you're delivering business, you need to have customers there, you can have your family and friends approve the addresses, verify the addresses for you. So that in either of these cities, when someone searches for your keyword, you show up on the first result. So this is very, very scalable. If you're a local business, it's great. You do it for Bangalore or Pune or Mumbai, wherever you are. If you're an international business, you do it for all the locations that you can get an address verified. And essentially, in all of these towns and cities, when someone searches for this keyword, they can see you on the first result. So it's a simple local search hack. It's a hack because it doesn't take years for you to rank. It doesn't require any money from you, except for maybe if you don't have an address, you might need to get a virtual address for the short time. Once the listing is approved, a lot of people can go on your website or they can call you. They don't necessarily see a Google Maps listing and come to your address unless you're a really local business like a restaurant or a bar and so on. But if, for example, for me, I get a lot of people on the website from this result. I get a lot of people who call me from this result. That works out really well in terms of conversions for me. So I've done this for Bangalore. I'm currently expanding this growth hack, scaling it for Pune, for Mumbai, for New Delhi, essentially trying to conquer all of these cities. Using the same keywords, growth hacking consultant, because that's the exact thing that people are searching for when they're looking for me. And you can do the same thing. So one of the characteristics of a growth hack is that it should be very scalable, which this is. And sometimes you use technology to help it scale even more. So that's the local search hack. If there are any questions, feel free to ask.
Yeah, I think people want links to the blog you just showed, so I'm just looking that up, Rishabh. I'll share that with the people who want it.
Sure. So it's on Medium. There's free to share that.
So yeah, Siddharth says, using same number in different listing, doesn't Google block this?
No. So the phone number can be, you can also have a local number of the office. Otherwise, you can use the same number as well. What I've done is, I've put different addresses, I've put the same number, however. But if you're going for a virtual office, it becomes really easy because just like a week back, I took this address from a virtual office in Singapore because I've heard there's a lot of requirement for growth hacking in Singapore as it's picking up, and they gave me their office phone number. And if someone calls, I just told them that I need an answering service as well. So it's as cheap as $10 a month. they're going to just redirect the calls to me. So you can have these redirection call services for $10 a month, and you can have the returns from this are much greater than the investment that you put into rank on this first result. However, you will notice that most people are going to come on your website, especially if you're in a business like mine. But if you're in a business where you need people to call you, I suggest you have a mobile number and you put it everywhere. Prepaid SIMs are really cheap in India. You can use that to your advantage. That's an opportunity for you. You can have different SIMs in different places. You know, there's all kinds of stuff that you can do. But the point is that if you rank in a city for the first result, the advantages will definitely outgrow the process that you have to go through. So if you need any help in terms of scaling it, feel free to tweet to me as well. If there's any other question, let me know. Otherwise, I'll move on to the fourth growth hack.
No, not really. I mean, Hiren was just commenting on what you said. Details of such offices forwarding call companies.
Okay, sure. I think that's fine. He can look it up on Google or something. We're going to move to the next hack. So this definitely has been out there in the market. I think it's going to be really big in 2018 again. It was big in 2017, expert roundup posts. Not going to spend too much time on this. I think a lot of you might know this. So expert roundup, fairly simple. You find these experts in your domain. We did this SEO 2018 expert roundup, which went really well. And essentially what we did is curated a list of experts. Asked them to submit their opinion about 2018. We published this somewhere at the end of 2017, which is a good time to submit an expert roundup post, but you promote it in Jan. That's a good time to promote it. However, you can still do a lot of stuff before April. You can do an expert roundup post. You can start this right away. It's very simple. You choose your topic. Let's say you can say top 25 digital marketing influencers share their thoughts about inbound marketing, something like that for LeadSquared. And then for me, it was SEO because I was selling a SEO course back then. So we are now selling a growth hacking masterclass, so we can do something regarding that. But that's the kind of stuff that you need to think about. So what is the campaign that you're currently running, and get experts from that field. Help them, get them answer your question, and then tweet the link out to these people. So typically I use Twitter to get influencers and LinkedIn to get influencers. And then I send them a message on LinkedIn that your opinion has been published. And a lot of these influencers also have email conversations with me. So I send them the link on email. And then you just don't have to do anything. You just have to wait and watch. Once you send them the link, you'll see that most of these influencers, in fact, out of 25 influencers that we interviewed recently, 22 of them shared the link on their social media. And their social media means a huge follower base. On an average, they have 50,000 people on Twitter, and even more on Facebook, probably 20,000 on LinkedIn, those kinds of people. And when they share your link, you get the traffic back to your website. So you're basically using other people's following or other people's influence in this case. So like I said, the general theme with growth hacking will be other people's networks. In this case, you're going to be using other people's influence. And it's free, it's fast, you get a lot of visibility, your content is shared. This is much better than writing a blog yourself, because you also don't have to create content for this. The experts create content for you. I'm not sure why the market has ignored this. I see a lot of this happening with US publications and so forth. I don't see a lot of Indian companies doing this that well. So if you do this, it's still an opportunity for you to get visibility. So any questions on this one before we move forward?
No, Rishabh, but we have questions from number 3. So do you want to take it up at the end?
We can take it up now. That's okay.
Okay. So starting off with Arjun's question, he says, what are LSI search options?
Mm-hmm. So just go to lsigraph.com. That's a good website where you can get started. What it means is you're looking for semantic keywords. So Google just doesn't necessarily look for the keyword density anymore. They don't care if you have the same keyword 100 times. In fact, that's not really good. But similar keywords. So it's latent semantic indexing and semantic keywords can help you go a long way. You can use synonyms of keywords. You can use keywords which are related to a specific keyword, keywords which people also search for when they search for this keyword. Those are the kinds of things which fall into that category. I think it's a more of a SEO thing, so I'm not going to go too much in depth on that. But LSI Graph is what I use. It's a fairly straightforward tool which lets you put in a keyword and it gives you all of these other keywords which are LSI keywords which you can put in your content. So the idea is when you create content, you first choose your main keywords and you put that into this tool. You get the LSI keywords and you put that back into your content and you have a good SEO optimized piece of content.
All right. Again, moving, these are questions for point number three. So Shabana says, we are a professional training organization offering different courses. With Google search, if we have same office with different courses, then Google does not show the duplicate address. Then what do we do?
The same office is basically like the same address is going to be only one listing. So again, the idea of this was to have multiple addresses. But if you're optimizing for one specific address, then you cannot optimize for all your courses because you have limited fields where you can actually enter content. You have the listing name, you have the listing address, you have the listing category, you have the listing keywords and description when you actually go inside the listing. However, I do have a tip for you. We have a similar problem with one of our clients, which was doing co-working, as well as they were an accelerator, as well as they were an incubator. They were selling a lot of services. They were doing a lot of different kind of stuff. And what we did is we spoke to people in the co-working space and asked them to review the business. And when they review the business, we asked them to include those keywords in the reviews. You know, because as a business, when you're posting the business profile, you don't have enough place to include all of these keywords. So let's say if you're selling 5 different courses, you can probably include keywords related to 2 or 3 courses, but then 2 or 3 courses will be missed out. So what you do is for these 2 courses where you could not optimize the Google My Business listing, you go to the students who are taking these courses and ask them to review the course. Don't ask them to review the academy itself, or don't ask them to review the institute because that's already taken care of. You ask them to review that specific course. So that the keywords related to that course will at least come in the review section. And Google also scans the review section for keywords when they show up your results on the local pack. So that's how the SEO for the local pack works, the algorithm for the local pack works. If, for instance, you will see that I have around 19 reviews, and if you actually look at the reviews, which is obviously natural, if you look at the 19 reviews, you'll see that most people are talking about growth hacking because I have a very strong focus on growth hacking. However, Mapplinks Academy, which is my education business, they also sell SEO courses. So they have reviews of courses where people are saying, you know, your SEO course is great and stuff like that. So you cannot optimize all the courses and all the keywords in the listing itself. So you should optimize those keywords in the review section. That's the way to go about it.
All right. I think, Rishabh, we can move forward now.
Sure. Great. So hack number 5 is side project marketing, my absolute favorite. If you're a mobile app, if you're a web app, if you are a big services company, it will work for all of these people. The concept is simple. It's much easier to sell a free side product than to sell a big paid service or a big paid product. And side project is, in this case, I'm going to see it as a better alternative and show you how it is a better alternative to blogging. Because it gives more value to people. Let me just show you this by an example. So first, the problem is blogging and SEO obviously take ages and ads annoy people. So this is the example that I'm going to use to explain you. Now, Crew is a website which is something like Guru or freelancer.com. It lets you hire people for your project, hire freelancers for your project. Now, one of the things Crew was doing is they were doing a lot of these marketing campaigns, and their problem was, you know, we need to find a way to get people to come and sign up for a free account to start hiring without having to go through the whole process of blogging. Now, their main source of traffic was the blog. Instead of blog, what they did is they started writing these, they started making these products. So for instance, once they wrote a blog about free images that you can use in your next freelancing project or in your next website project, and they saw that a lot of these website owners would read the blog, however, no one would sign up for an account. Right, so we haven't acquired the email address yet. So they launched this side project called Unsplash. So if you've heard of Unsplash, it's a nice place where you can go and find free photos for your project. Could be for your website, could be for your marketing campaigns. And this was a side project for them, which was getting them signups using, and the signup, they could sell people the subscription for Crew. So it was like a lead generation process for them, but it was easier for people to sign up for this free thing than to pay for Crew. And eventually Unsplash started generating around 11 million unique visitors a month for Crew, right? For the main business, which is Crew. So the idea here is you find a problem that your target audience has, which is not being solved by the entire big main product that you're selling or the main service that you're selling, but you solve the smaller problem by a free app or product so that people sign up there and then you can convert them for the main product. Hence, we call it side project marketing. So if you look up Crew, they have 6 side projects. Now, this is a very interesting one. It's also my favorite. I've implemented the same thing for my business, for my services business. So app versus website, which is right for my project? Now, people who are probably in the decision-making process, now in that buyer's journey stage where they're looking to decide, you know, if it's going to be an app that they're going to build or a website, which is sort of they're considering both of these options. You can either write a blog about why you should go for an app instead of a website, or you can write a blog, or you can make this product which will help you decide app versus website. It's basically the same amount of effort because it's just a type form. So go to typeform.com, create a form, put in a couple of questions, people fill in the questions, and the app tells you whether you should go for an app or you should go for a website for your project. The fun thing is when you put in all these questions, you have to take the email address and the lead information of this person. So I figured out after using this technique is that whenever I think of writing a blog, I can pretty much convert it into a form. And instead of writing a blog, I can ask people different questions, take their lead information, and my conversion rate goes to 100% because I know that people will have to fill in their lead information because, and they're okay with it because they're going to get a customized answer for their requirement. They're going to get a customized answer if an app is better or a website is better. But if they read a blog, they don't feel that it's a customized. All the blogs are perceived as the same value by people because all brands are just doing blogs. So you're perceived at the same level as your competitors because they're doing blogs, you're doing blogs. But when you do a side product, people perceive it as much more higher value than just a blog. And also since you're doing custom information, at least that's how it feels like, they'll be more than happy to put in their lead information. So people will either put in their lead information or not. But when you look at a blog, they will read your blog and there is very low probability that they'll actually leave lead information after reading your blog. So this is a very good alternative for blogging in 2018. If you think that you can make a form instead of making a blog and put in the information as an output of the form, do that using Typeform for free instead of writing the blog itself. So that would be my best alternative. I also want to share the statistic with you that the side projects of Crew generate 40% of Crew's revenue. So it's a source of 40% of their revenue. They bring in around 100,000 email subscribers from these projects and are the top 5 referring websites to Crew. And the other good thing about this is there's no dependency on social media channels. You're not really getting your traffic from social media. You own these people because they're your email subscribers. So no matter what happens to the algorithms of social media channels, no matter what the organic reach is, you still have access to these people. 40% I think is a very impressive number of revenue from side projects like this. And these are very, very simple side projects to build. It's easy to promote side projects compared to promoting paid projects. So you can promote side projects on Product Hunt, which is another hack which we're going to discuss today. you can promote them in a lot of places for free. You can share it in groups, and ultimately you can send people from this side project to the paid project. There are other good examples. Buffer has a side project called Pablo, and Social Media 101. HubSpot has a side project called Website Grader. HubSpot also has a side project called Agency Grader, which is how they generate a lot of leads for their main product using these side projects. Any question on this before we move to the next hack?
So Sudhanshu says side project to be on the same domain, or it's a different sub product linking back to the original?
I prefer to keep it a separate domain, a separate product, but yes, always have a link back to the main product. I also keep the branding the same. So for instance, if you look at Pablo, it still has Buffer's branding. If you look at Website Grader, it still has HubSpot's branding. Unsplash, however, has a link. It's not being shown here, but they do have a link back to Crew. Here, if you click on the link, it shows back to Crew. So there has to be a link back. It could be on a separate domain, but it needs to have two things. One is the similar branding, and one is even the parent logo can be included, and the other thing is a link back to the parent product website.
All right. Sumit says, can you show a form type which you use?
Yeah, so just go on typeform.com. I use the same one. Or you can just go to mapplinks.com and see the side project that we have. Anyways, that can be solved just by Typeform. Because the reason I use Typeform is it's more visually appealing. It has very high conversion rates. Even if you see, I think one of these, there is a side project by HubSpot, which is called Create My User Personas or something like that. So create buildmypersonas.com or something. Just search for that. They also use Typeform. Things like Pablo and Unsplash, however, are more you know, are bigger side projects. We don't need to really go into that much detail. But small side projects like app versus website, and how much does an app cost, that works really well for me if I'm selling my services. So Mapplinks is a services company where we do websites. We just say, how much does a website cost? People fill in their information, and that is a very, very qualified lead for us, because this person is looking for how much to pay for a service which we offer. So all of these basic cost calculators and forms can be built using Typeform. So just go to typeform.com. That's the tool for that.
Okay, I think we can move forward. I have shared the links that you mentioned. I forwarded that to the people here.
Great. The sixth hack is another SEO hack, where you obviously don't have to do SEO for ranking on the first page. This works in a period of a month. You can start ranking on the first page for any keyword. The trick is to find a keyword which has a specific pattern of results, which I'm going to show you now. If you're a mobile app, this is the best thing that you can do for your business promotion. For all the mobile apps or the web apps that I've implemented this for, it's worked really well. If you're a services company, again, it can work really well for you. If you're a B2C company, it's sort of just about finding the right keyword. If you find the right keyword, it's going to work well. But if you don't find the right keyword, again, you might rank on the second or third page and then have to push up your ranking on the first page, which again takes time. So it's all about finding the right keyword. We use the concept of OPSR, which is other people's search rankings, in order to rank our result on the first page. So the idea of a growth hacker is a digital marketer would say, this is the keyword, this is my keyword research, this is my competitor research, this is my content calendar, this is my off-page plan, this is my on-page plan, and this is how I'm going to rank for this keyword in a few months or years or whatever. In contrast, how a growth hacker thinks is that these are people who are already ranking for these keywords. Why can't I rank on their search results and hence rank on the first page of Google? So I'll show you how this works. Now, I've taken an example here. Let's say you have a dating app. Okay. In this case, I'm going to assume that you're a startup and you have a dating app. So if you go to google.com now, and if you search for apps like Tinder, which is basically like dating apps, let's say, these are the top 10 results which you'll see. Okay, so you can go ahead and try this right now. If you're from India, these are the results that you're going to see. And you probably have a different results based on how much information Google has about you. Now, these are the top 10 results, so let's go through these results. If you are a competitor of Tinder or if you're a dating app, this is the first thing that you see. Apps like Tinder, 13 best alternative dating apps. Now you see this is sort of like a directory, app directory, where you can go and submit your app. Makes sense. The second one is a Play Store. Let's just ignore this. The third one is 10 alternative dating apps. This is more like a blog where you can go and either put an advertisement or you can talk to the editor to include your link, right? Now, assuming the amount of money people spend on SEO, you will be really happy with this, with the results of this process. When you go for the next one, you see best Tinder alternatives, more like a listing / directory where you can submit your app. Knowyourmobile.com is definitely like a directory. You can submit your app yourself without having to go through the editor. Five dating apps, you know, with Huffington Post is a little tricky to get into, but you can talk to the editor anyways. Reviews, xp.com again looks like a directory where you can submit your app. So most of the times you'll find that 70% of the results are results where you can actually go and submit your app. If you search for something like companion apps for Tinder, you'll see that three of the results on the first page are Reddit and other forums where you can just go and talk about your app and submit your link. And then you start submitting your link to all these directories, which are already ranking on the first page. They're now giving a link back to you. So imagine if Google sees that 7 out of the top 10 results on Google for this keyword, for apps like Tinder, are linking back to your website, to your app, they're going to push your result on the first page. So that's how this works. That's how the whole process works. The opportunity here is other people's search rankings. Now, there's a startup which has implemented this, which is called Fire for Tinder, and they started ranking, you know, like in a month on the first page. If you search for companion apps for Tinder, they're there on the first page. That's the keyword that they targeted. You have to find the right keyword where you can get people who are searching for it, and also you can get results which have directories and forums and boards where you can go and submit. So just directory submission doesn't work, but if you're going to get your link on the results which are already ranking in the first page, you have a major opportunity to drive traffic. Even if you don't rank because of this process, you have a link inside the top 10 links on Google, which also makes a lot of sense. However, the way the algorithm works, you are directly going to get the search juice because of being on these pages, and that juice is going to push you up on search results as well. So this is how the process works. It's called other people's search rankings. So find the keyword you wish to rank for, research the search results, get listed on these blogs or content rankings on the first page. Any questions before we move to the seventh hack?
Well, we have questions for this hack and the previous one. Okay. So I'll start off with the ones for this, I suppose, and then go back to that.
Sure.
Yeah. So Siddharth says, but the listing links are no follow. Does it still help?
Yeah, because essentially what you're doing is, the first thing what you're doing is you're getting 80% of the traffic for this keyword to also see your placement. So let's say, for instance, you would understand that most of the clicks are going to happen on the top 3, top 4 results, and then you're going to get some clicks, 20%, 30% of the clicks on the rest of the results. Now, all of these clicks, the first thing that they see is inside the page is the content, and they see your ad or they see your listing. You're going to drive majority of your traffic from there. The way this worked for the other app is that they drove so much traffic from these and you can also see that the new algorithm considers things like the click-through rate and all of the things into account. So if they're all exiting the page of this directory to your app, which should be a good app, of course, you get all this traffic to your app. So that's the first thing. And secondly, you don't most of these directories and listings, you have to obviously do a check. Like, for example, I don't know if knowyourmobile.com is a no follow. I don't know if Reviews XP is or not. You know, that's something that you need to check. But of course, I'm sure that that's something that you can quickly, you know, put in the list through a script and check how it works. I also recommend expanding this hack outside of the first page. Don't worry about that, you're going to get less traffic from there, but still, if you have listings on the second page and third page where you think that you can put your app, definitely go ahead and do that. And with growth hacking, the ultimate objective is definitely not to just have rankings, but mainly to have traffic and conversions, which is why this hack really works well for us.
Right. I'm moving on to Karun's question. Let me know, Rishabh, if you want more of an elaboration there. So he says, what if any companies' rankings are on top instead of directories?
Yeah, there will
be. What if the companies are ranking on top? Yeah.
So usually that happens if you're searching for the long keywords. Like, for instance, if you're searching for, let me give you an example. Let's say there's a company which sells logistics, and you search for logistics companies in Bangalore. You will get a couple of companies. You'll get probably three companies and seven directories or seven listings. So just ignore those three. I mean, 70% of the results, even in this case, you can see Happn is like the business itself. Tinder on the App Store is the business itself. So these are just to be ignored. But imagine if I search for dating apps, I might get a lot of businesses and a very few directories. But when I search for apps like Tinder, I have chosen a keyword which will get me a lot of directories, and people still are searching for it. So that's what you need to keep in mind. If you're getting too many businesses, you're definitely searching for the wrong keywords.
Okay. Just to remind the audience, we're 7 minutes past four, so I'm just going to speed things up. Hey, Rain, there goes your question. So for how long can this work, and does it need to be monitored to find if these links are still available?
Okay, good question. So I would recommend running this once in 3 months. So once in 3 months, you put the same keyword. Make sure you do the outreach the same way that you would do. Of course, if the link is still present, ignore that website. Most of the times you'll find that the link is active. The clients that we've done this hack for, the links are mostly active. And once you start ranking yourself, you just have to make sure that you have a good CTR and people stay on your website and all that stuff, so that Google keeps you on the first result for this, first page for this result.
Okay. Now the next two questions, Rishabh, are from the previous hack. Do you want to take them at the end, or should I just carry on with the question?
Yeah, sure. Let's take them up. The side project, okay. Yeah.
So there's a question by DJ. So he says, when you're talking about writing articles in place of blogs, so are you talking about infographics?
No, I'm talking about creating side projects instead of blogs, not writing articles. I think she missed the whole point of the hack was that you make a side project, which is like a form, or it has a specific function, so that you can be perceived as highly valuable compared to your competitors who are just writing blogs. You can obviously embed the side project in different blogs. That's a different thing. But we are not creating articles. We are creating side projects. The method that you're talking about, infographics, is a completely different aspect of things. That's more of a digital marketing process. It's not exactly a growth hack. This is a growth hack because the side project can be created very fast using something like Typeform, and it converts, it pushes your conversion ratio up to 100% because people have to fill in their email ID in order to use this tool, which is not possible with infographics as well. The reason why I'm not talking about infographics is that it functions almost like a blog in terms of the lead generation. People might or might not fill the lead form. But with a side project, they have to fill the lead form.
Right. Moving to Ashish's question. How can the wastage be avoided in side project marketing? People who are just going to use the free service and exit.
Right. So, I mean, that job is usually done by your email marketing tool. And what I typically make sure is that I don't have a side project with just three fields in a form. You know, then I just get a lot of these inquiries which don't make any sense at all. So if you're taking up the example of, let's say, how much does it cost to make a website, and if you just ask them, hey, how many pages do you need in the website? Do you need a, whatever technology do you need, a bootstrap website or whatever. If you have just three questions, you'll see that all of these random leads are coming into your form. So it's better to have a more descriptive tool. So people who are really serious, like usually I have like 7 fields to 8 fields in my tool where I say, how many pages do you need? Do you need this functionality? Do you need that? Do you need a card? Do you need a checkout? Do you need e-commerce integration? Do you need social media integration? Blah, blah, blah. Do you need a Google Maps? You know, stuff like that. So the more in-depth it is, you'll get a lot of serious people who are actually looking for someone to develop their app or website. So that would be my number one advice. Just don't keep the tool very short. I've seen people who rush through creating side projects. They just put in 2 or 3 questions. And they get a lot of leads which they can't use. However, this is going to be obviously taken care of once you do the email marketing campaigns to these people who you get the leads from. I usually put everyone who has used my side project into a specific drip campaign based on which side project they've used and which option they've selected. For instance, if I'm doing how much does an app cost, I have an option to select, are you an app developer or are you a business owner? Or are you a designer or are you an entrepreneur? What kind of person you are? If there's an app developer, I put him into a completely different drip campaign which essentially doesn't sell directly. But if it's a business owner, I'm going to just say, this is the cost that you calculated. This is how much we are going to charge to do that for you. Are you interested in our service? It's going to be more straightforward. So it's going to go to a different drip campaign based on what persona the person fits into. That's another thing that you can plug into your side project in order to reduce waste.
Okay, and last question before we move to the next hack, you can choose to take it at the end because of the nature of the question. So Amit says, what would be the good backlink strategy in 2018 to get better ranking?
Yeah, I think we'll take it at the end. So I think any questions specific to the hack itself, let's take them up right away. Something outside of that, we should take it at the end. So anything else on related to the hack itself, like in terms of side project marketing or?
No, not yet. I mean, I think we can just move forward.
Cool. So we have hack number 7, which is basically going to give you entire lead databases. And there are these services, there are many of these services like built with, and you can get their database of leads just like that. And you have enough leads to prospect. You don't really need your own lead generation engine. The reason and the specific cases, let's talk about that first. The specific cases that this works well is mostly B2B and most of the time in cases where you know what technology your prospective business clients are going to use. And I'll share that how that works. Now, in this presentation, I did keep a couple of hacks which work for B2B because every time I get this question, and this mindset of people that sometimes they assume that growth hacking works only for B2C, which is definitely not true at all. So Built With gives you something like this. It's a very cool list with all kinds of information about a business. And I just exported this random list to give you an example. It has a lot of email IDs. It's not a single email ID, but a lot of it has big businesses, small businesses, all kinds of companies that you can export. And you can use this for something like PR, you can use this for an outreach, you can use this for all sorts of things to run email campaigns, you can use it to plan automated tweets, you can use it to get shout outs from people on Instagram. There's unlimited applications of this sort of a list, and it even has different filters where you can sort companies by their size. You can sort companies by, the technology that they use, and all of different kinds of stuff like that. So you'd get a mass email database without really hacking into anything, but you're using the Built With network, right? So this is other people's network. In this case, the network for us is Built With. However, you are not limited to Built With. There are different services that you can use to do this. So step one is, you have to target your prospect by the technology they use. Like for instance, most of my clients are like small businesses to startups to small businesses, sometimes large corporates. I know that most of the small businesses will be using WordPress for their business website. If I'm targeting e-commerce clients, I know that they'll be using one of these, like they'll be using Shopify, WooCommerce, Magento, or any of these to build their store. So I know a list of the technologies that my prospective clients are going to use. So what you need to understand here is we are generating the client persona using the technology of their website. So if you don't have a specific technology for your clients, you can always target multiple technologies. So you can select WordPress, Joomla, Drupal, blah, 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 and so on. You can select a lot of different technologies and then export the leads from these. But you can filter them by the size, the number of employees, the revenue, and all kinds of stuff. So here's a simple link that you can use. So go to trends.builtwith.com/website-list/Shopify. You can change this to trends.builtwith.com/website-list/WordPress/Joomla/Magento/ whatever technology you want to feed in. So this gives you the names, titles, emails, location, telephone numbers of all the websites using Shopify. So it's as simple as that. You just go to this link and you get a list which you can export to something like this, you know, and it's beautiful. You can then import this to various tools. You can import the emails, you can import the LinkedIn, you can import the Facebook, all kinds of things can be automated. You can build a Facebook bot and use all these pages and start talking to them. There is just so much you can do with this hack. And it's probably the number one hack for B2B businesses who are looking for lead generation without having to have a team, without having to, you know, do a lot of this kind of stuff. As long as they know what technology their prospects are going to use, they can just go to builtwith.com. Now, the other thing I want to tell you here is that BuiltWith is not the only service which does this. So there's so many similar websites which sort of do the same thing, and you can get leads like this from these websites. So that's for B2B companies. Any questions on this before we move to the eighth hack?
Not really. Let's move on.
Okay, great. So the next one is how to connect with business decision makers. Now, I found this to be very useful because in most cases, you just need to talk to the right people. Again, for B2B companies, the idea here is OPN is other people's newsletters. So drip campaigns are a big thing. And what you want to do is you want to make a list of target companies, of all the companies you want to connect with. So you want to make a list of the companies. You don't know the decision makers yet, but let's say you make a list of these startups and small businesses and big firms. Just make a list of all these companies and go ahead and sign up for their email newsletter. Or if they have a product, you go and sign up for their product demo. So step two is basically you're trying to enter their sales cycle, right? So think of it the other way around. You want to sell to them, but you put your growth mindset on and you are entering their sales cycle. And I'll tell you why we'll do this. But what they'll be doing to you is that now since you are in their sales cycle, they're going to be sending you their drip campaigns once you've signed up. Now, this works extremely well if you're targeting smaller companies. If you're targeting startups, it works very well because most of the drip campaigns for startups come from the email ID of the founder himself or herself. You will get the drip campaign from the founder, from the CEO, or from one of the board of directors of the startup. If you're looking for a very big business, this method might not be the right one for you. But this growth hack works really well if you're looking for smaller companies. What I typically do is I engage with their email campaign. So if it's a drip campaign, I reply saying, hey, I'm liking your product so far. You'll typically have this personalized campaign. Hey, I'm so-and-so, the founder of this startup, and this is what I do, and thank you for signing up for this product. And then soon you'll see that you get deeper into the drip campaign and you get two or three emails. What I do is on the third email, I reply asking for a call or meeting to discuss about the business, and that's all. I just keep it open-ended. Now, since these people are trying to sell to you, they are very happy to set up the meeting with you, and now you have the decision maker or the influencer connected with you, and this is where you can make your pitch. You obviously understand their pitch, you understand what they do, but the idea is that 60% of this time using this workflow, you will connect and be on a call one-to-one with the decision maker of the business directly. And the rest 40%, I've realized that you will connect with someone who works very closely with the decision maker. It could be the marketing head, it could be the sales lead, it could be one of these people. And these people also have some sort of influence on the decision makers of these companies. So that's the hack to connect with business decision makers. I think this is an opportunity for you then to pitch and sell whatever you plan to sell. So that's a purely B2B sort of a growth hack. Now, any questions on this?
No, but we have a question on the previous hack, actually. Yeah. So Arjun said, any other example of website like built with?
So any website which tells you the technology behind a website. So what you need to do is just Google built with alternatives and you'll get a lot of these, an entire list of these websites. However, you know, start with built with, and once you run out of options, you'll have a lot of these leads from built with. Once you run out of those leads, you go for something else. I have used something called, it starts with D, I'm forgetting the name now. But I'll let you know, I'll sort of, if you tweet to me, I'll just reply with the name. I've used two of these websites so far, but I'm sure that there are much more websites which do the same thing. Essentially, we are looking for like something which tells you the technology of of behind a website. I think Pipe Candy is another one which you can use. That's mostly for retail and e-commerce, however, which is why I didn't mention it in the example. So Pipe Candy is for e-commerce, built with is general. You can use built with for anything.
All right, Hiren, I know you want to see steps 2 and 3 for hack number 7. You can have a quick glance at it, I suppose, but we'll be sending you the deck anyway. So you're free to see it later. So let's just move on then, Rishabh.
Sure. So since I mentioned Product Hunt to promote the side project, I think a lot of people ask questions about the side project, but one of the interesting questions I did not get, I was expecting to get, is we are going to promote the main product, but we have to promote the side project anyway. So can you give us some advice on doing that, which is the question I always get. That's why I included this slide. So this is the best way I feel to launch a product or promote a product. If you have a mobile app or a web app, it's going to be really useful for you. Even if you don't, if you have a services business, it's very simple. Now you can hunt a product because you have side projects. So if you're a services business, make a side project and hunt it on Product Hunt. So just hunting it on Product Hunt is not going to get you sufficient results. So there's a hack for this, which is a simple 4-step hack. The first thing that you need to do is you need to find influencers on Twitter which have the same target audience that you're looking for. So let's say if I'm promoting LeadSquared, and if I'm going to, and LeadSquared makes a side project, which I'm going to hunt on Product Hunt, I'm going to look for people like, you know, people who engage with LeadSquared competitors or people who have marketeers, digital marketeers, SEO guys, lead generation guys, or marketing heads, managers as their target audience. And now the fun thing, the loophole here, or the opportunity here, is that the Twitter handle, which is step two, the Twitter handle is the same as the Product Hunt usernames, because, and this comes because of the fact that Product Hunt used Twitter for their login initially when they started. So most of the influencers are old members, which means that they had to use their Twitter to sign up for Product Hunt, which means that the Product Hunt URL or username is going to be the same as their Twitter username. And what I did for a client is that we ran this script which would map the Twitter handles, which would pick up a list of all these Twitter handles and convert it to their Product Hunt URLs. And it's very simple. You just remove the @ and you put producthunt.com/ before it. It becomes their Product Hunt URL. And then you can run a script to automate an outreach to all of these influencers and say, hey, do you want to hunt this product? It has cool features. It has a good parent company. It is by LeadSquared. And it does this, and your target audience might, you know, get help using this product. And you'll be surprised at how many people want to hunt your product on Product Hunt. And then you start shortlisting these influencers. So let's say you have different influencers. You find someone with 1 million followers, let's say, and you say, okay, he's going to launch my product. And when you hunt this product, you get the followers of these people to come and use your app or product. So we did this for a client recently, and we got 10,000 downloads in the first week through Product Hunt. And if you're a new product, definitely works. If you're not a new product, if you're a service, then you should make a side product and do this. And once you have 10,000 people using your side product, you have an email database of 10,000 people to do an outreach for your main service or product. So that's how you need to think about this. And it's all going to be done in a matter of a few weeks versus digital marketing campaigns that run for months. The idea here is to hack into the Twitter followers of influencers and not on their network on Product Hunt. Right? So when people think Product Hunt launch, they think they are using the Product Hunt network, but in this case, the growth hack is going to use the Twitter followers of Product Hunt influencers who are going to hunt your product. And the other influencers that you do an outreach to, you're going to share a link of the hunted product so they can upvote it on Product Hunt, or they can recommend it to other people and so forth. So this is probably the best way to get a couple of thousands of downloads in a few weeks, and also helps in promoting your side project. So it works hand in hand with the other growth hack. Any questions on this before we move on to the last hack?
Right. So Raj has a question. So he says, Twitter hack to gain prospects will help acquire influencers for Product Hunt marketing. Is that correct?
Can you repeat that? I'm sorry.
So Raj says, Twitter hack to gain prospects will help acquire influencers for Product Hunt marketing. Is that correct?
So slightly different. I think... So Twitter is just the channel that we are finding Product Hunt influencers on. You are not finding prospects on Twitter. You are going to find prospects in the followers of the Twitter handles, which are also Product Hunt influencers. So let's go through this again. You find influencers on Twitter who have the same target audience as yours, but these are people who are also on Product Hunt. Okay. Now to make this process easy for you, what you can do is go to, I'll give you a pre-step for this. So step one, you go to producthunt.com and you find apps which are similar to yours or in the same categories, and you see people who have hunted those apps, right? So the people who have hunted those apps are going to be hunters or Product Hunt influencers, and you go to their Twitter following, you go to their Twitter page by using step two. You can map the Twitter handles to product usernames and see which one of those has the highest influence. So now you have a person who's a hunter on Product Hunt, but also an influencer on Twitter. His followers are going to be your prospects, okay? But that's going to happen when he hunts your product on Product Hunt. So that's how the process works. So you have to find these people who are both influencers on Twitter and hunters on Product Hunt. The best way to do that is to go on Product Hunt, look for apps in your category, and see who's the hunter for those apps. Any other question?
Last one by Satish before we move to the last hack. He says, if I use Product Hunt, is it possible to maintain my brand name?
Yes, you can. So Product Hunt is just going to list your business, your app, and you can put your brand name, you can put your branding, you can have a cover image. Imagine it is something like a Facebook for launching products. So you have your cover photo, you have different photos that you can upload, and ultimately it's going to send people back to your product, back to your link. So your branding is completely safe when you hunt something on Product Hunt. Okay. So the last hack, which is more like a hack to give you more hacks. This can work for B2B as well as B2C. And this is so far, I think, my most favorite hack, because it is sort of an engine which lets you keep generating hacks. I'm just going to talk about this before we close. How this works is you find a competitor in your space. Now, this competitor could be, let's say you have a business goal and you have a specific target audience that you want to acquire, that you want, you know, to run referral campaigns, retention, whatever, awareness, acquisition, whatever it might be. You find a competitor who has a same target audience as yours. Now, it might not necessarily be a direct competitor. It could be another business, but just with the same kinds of people that you also want for your business, right? And then you make a sheet. So we call this the ICE sheet. So you can Google ICE, ICE sheet, wherein we'll make a list of all the growth campaigns or the growth hacks that this competitor is running. It could also be a business if let's say you are a startup in India and you have a business in the US which is doing the exact same thing as you, or a business in the UK which has the same target audience as you, just make a list of their growth hacks. And the simple way of doing this is to find where they're driving their traffic from every month. So if, let's say, last month you go to similarweb.com or you analyze their Tweepy or you basically do a lot of the competitor analysis. So SimilarWeb says that they get most of the traffic from Reddit in November 2017, and they got a lot of traffic from Quora in December 2017, and they got a lot of traffic from Medium in Jan 2017. It clearly shows that they've run some growth campaigns on these channels every month, which means that you can go back and trace what growth hacks they've been running. And it may sound simple, but it's actually the best growth hack that you can use. Go spy on your competitors, see what's been successful for them. If it is driving a lot of leads and traffic to their website, it can do the same thing for you. Just borrow, copy, and paste whatever they're doing. Run the same growth hacks for your business, and you'll be on your way. So that's sort of the summary of all the growth hacks. And it's also a growth hack to enable you to get many, many more growth hacks going forward. And the more growth mindset that you build, the easier it will be for you to re-engineer these growth hacks from your competitors. So I'm assuming there'll be no questions on this one. If you are interested in learning the process of growth hacking, then just go outside. Just not limit yourself to these growth hacks. You want to learn more hacks. You want to learn the entire process. I have a free growth hacking course that you can take. The link is bit.ly/learngh. So just go on the link and you can sign up for this course for free. We also have a masterclass in case you're going to the next level growth hacking. You want to become a professional growth hacker, or you want to run growth hacking campaigns for your business. Then the right thing for you is the masterclass, which is bit.ly/ghmasterclass. 1-8 for 2018. There's only one masterclass that we are doing this year. There's only one single batch. And so if you're interested, just go on this link. So the free course is a good place to start, and the masterclass is if you're going to, if you're thinking of taking your growth hacking skills to the next level. If you have any other doubts, questions, just feel free to send me a mail. I think we can take one or two questions before we actually end this session, Shibani. So if you think there's some relevant questions to the hacks, I would be happy to take them now. Otherwise, they can always tweet to me. Use the hashtag LSQWebinar, which we use for, if you've been here before, which I'm assuming you are, you know the hashtags to use. So anything else, Shibani, before we wind up?
Sure. There's one last question, and I'm taking this up because you mentioned competitors specifically. So sure. This is from Sophia, and she says, how can we know the growth hacking of our competitors?
Right. So the way I do this is, yeah, like I said, one of the things I do is I analyze where their traffic is coming from. So whenever a digital website or something is running a growth hack, you will, if the growth hack is successful, you will see a spike in their traffic from a specific source, which is the source they're using for their growth hacking, right? And SimilarWeb and other tools let you find where traffic is coming to a website from. The other thing that you do is also read the blogs of these companies, because a lot of times I found that they just publish their successful growth hacks on their blogs. The third thing that you do is you search for the brand mentions, because a lot of growth hacks are like, for instance, if a company is doing micro-influencer marketing, the influencer is going to mention them on Facebook, on Instagram, on LinkedIn, whatever source they might be using. There was a fashion company that we were working with, which was doing a micro-influencer marketing campaign on Instagram, and their idea was to give free products, free clothes essentially, which is their product, to these influencers and get a shout out from them on Instagram. So all we did is we reached out to the same influencers because we knew the hashtag of the campaign. we re-engineered it, sort of reverse engineered it, reached out to all of these influencers and did a similar campaign for us. It's just that we expanded the reach to multiple other influencers and sort of got a lot of leads from there. So those are different ways. I think it would also be dependent on the channel. That's why I mentioned that you need to really think like a growth hacker in order to actually spy on these hacks and figure out what they're doing. For instance, on Twitter, you can see what campaigns people are running on Twitter just by using Tweepy. So Tweepy also lets you see private Twitter lists of anyone on Twitter. So those are the kinds of things that you do. Again, it depends on the channel. A similar web is a good one to see the traffic that they're getting and where they're getting it from. So those are some ways to identify what they're doing. And of course, a lot of research is the best tool that you can use. Anything else?
Perfect. Thank you, Rishabh. No, I think we can end the session. Those of you who wanted the Bitly links, I have shared them. So just look at your question tab. You'll find it there. Those of you asking for the recording and the deck, yes, both will be sent to you. Please give me a couple of days to edit the recording first. So you don't expect it immediately. You'll get it very soon, though, in a couple of days. Yeah, any closing thoughts, Rishabh?
I think it's just that I feel that I'm really excited and I'm really proud of growth hacking this year. I think it's going to be amazing because when I really started talking about growth hacking, no one really knew the concept and people were just asking questions like, what is growth hacking and you know, why do we need growth hacking and stuff like that. So when I see these new questions, I feel really proud that the ecosystem has matured in terms of growth hacking education in as such and the process that we follow. So always happy to, definitely, of course, always happy to come back to LeadSquared and talk about this again. Thank you for having me, Shivani. It was a great session.
Thank you so much, Rishabh. And after all, you have spearheaded the growth hacking scene in India, I would say, because I've also been, you know, working here for the past couple, for 5 years or so. And if there's anything I've ever seen on growth hack, I've always seen your name there. So thank you so much, Rishabh. This is a very interesting session. I see our winners for today are asking how they can get the ebook. So yeah, Suri, Will and Fabio, don't worry. I'm going to email you separately. And Rishabh will also get in touch with you. And of course, you will get that ebook. So thank you everyone for joining the session today and for staying 30 minutes over time. I shall see you again in 2 weeks' time. Thanks again, Rishabh. Have a great weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you for having me. Bye.